Welcome. Thank you for an excellent turnout for a Friday right before a holiday. And thank you for many of you who were here a week ago to hear Steve Pfeiffer on a related topic. But thank you for making the time to do this, and thank you to Dr. Gary Samore for joining us this morning. Most of you know that Gary's a local boy who made good. After concluding a master's and PhD at Harvard University in the mid-1980s, he came to the Z Division and made an early mark there. We're going to spend some of this afternoon back in Z, so he has a sense of where that activity is in today's world. He departed Z for a tour at the Rand Corporation as an analyst. From there, he went to the State Department to work on non-proliferation issues. He was directly involved in the negotiations of the 1994 agreement with North Korea. From there, he went to the White House for his first tour at the White House, where he was special assistant to the president and senior director for non-proliferation and export controls. That was through the Clinton administration. He then departed and spent some time overseas. He was director of studies at the International Institute for Strategic Studies in London. Some of you will remember during that period, so the early 2000s, the IISS put out three strategic dossiers, which were sort of the definitive non-governmental and indeed better than many of the governmental analyses of the WMD programs of Iraq, Iran, and North Korea, a task in which he had a direct leading role. He left then London, having had enough of the gloomy weather, for the Council on Foreign Relations in New York, where he was vice president for studies up until the arrival of the Obama administration, at which time he was asked to go back to the White House and to serve as coordinator for arms control and weapons of mass destruction. In this capacity, he was the president's principal advisor on all matters related to arms control and the prevention of WMD proliferation and terrorism. When he discovered that he had run out of energy and maybe a sense of humor after 6 years in the White House, although not that I recall his ever having lost his sense of humor, although I did after my tenure in the Pentagon. He left to rejoin Harvard University, but this time as executive director of research at the Belfer Center, well known to many of us, a position he's had since early 2013. He's got a phenomenal breadth of experience and topics of interest to us, and he's going to talk today about where the president is and should be on the Prague Agenda in light of the Iran deal and in light of general developments in the global security environment. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. Gary Samore.
Thanks very much, Brad, and thanks to all of you for coming here on such a nice Friday. It's great to be back at the lab. I'm looking forward to learning more about the changes that have taken place since I worked here about 30 years ago. Hard to believe. So when I started to write down my thoughts for this topic, the more I worked on it, the more depressed I became, because I think the Iran deal, if it works, and we won't know that for many years, could be a very significant arms control measure to limit Iran's nuclear program and further nuclear proliferation in the Middle East. But we won't know the answer to that for a long time. And in any event, whether it's a success or a failure, the other obstacles to progress on the Prague Agenda are so great that it's hard to see any near-term prospects for dramatic advancement. So I'm warning you beforehand that this is not going to be a very uplifting speech. It's going to be more about obstacles and problems that lie in the way of advancing the Prague Agenda. Just to remind you what the Prague Agenda is, there were four main elements in President Obama's speech in Prague in early 2009. First, he talked about making efforts to reduce the role and the number of existing nuclear arsenals, starting first with the U.S. and Russia, and of course that led to the New START Treaty, but also multilateral arms control measures, including the Comprehensive Test Ban, the Fissile Material Production Treaty, and so forth. The second element of the Prague Agenda was to prevent further nuclear proliferation to additional countries, focus there on Iran and North Korea as the two most immediate threats, and in both cases the administration employed a dual-track strategy that combined pressure and military threats on one hand with offers of diplomatic engagement on the other. The third piece of the Prague Agenda was to strengthen nuclear security in order to prevent nuclear terrorism, to prevent terrorists from acquiring nuclear materials or weapons. And there the focus was on the series of nuclear security summits that started in Washington in March of 2010 and had been held every 2 years since then. And the fourth piece of the Prague Agenda was to promote nuclear energy. So when I left the White House, as Brad mentioned, in early 2013, I thought the President Obama's Prague Agenda had pretty much run out of gas. And, you know, frankly, one of the reasons I left is because it didn't look to me like there was really much expectation that we'd be able to make further progress on any of those four measures. The Russians, in the wake of the New START Treaty, the Russians had made very clear that they were not willing to accept additional reductions in their deployed strategic forces unless the U.S. was willing to accept significant limits on missile defense, which President Obama was not willing to do, and even if he was willing to do, the Senate would never ratify. So there didn't seem to be much prospect for advancement on the U.S.-Russian agenda, and also we had begun to learn about Russian violations of the INF Treaty, which looked like it was going to be yet another problem that couldn't be easily solved on the bilateral agenda. The Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty, which I never thought had much chance of being ratified, clearly was stuck in the Senate, especially after the Republicans took control in the 2010 election. So we were obviously not going to be able to make advancement there. The Fissile Material Cutoff Treaty was stuck in the Conference on Disarmament, being blocked by Pakistan and silently supported by several other countries, and there didn't seem to be any way to break that diplomatic deadlock. Nuclear diplomacy with North Korea had collapsed with the North Korean decision to renege on the so-called Leap Day Agreement by launching a new round of missile tests, and the administration was not very interested in trying to resume that diplomacy. And finally, we had had 4 years of very frustrating and unproductive diplomacy with Iran, and the expectation when I left is that the most likely person to be elected president was Dr. Jalili, who had headed the nuclear negotiations, and we knew that if Dr. Jalili was president, we could not expect to see much progress on the nuclear portfolio. The only bright spot in the Prague Agenda was that I thought the nuclear security summits, as I said, Washington, then Seoul, then The Hague, were still making some progress. But even there, I thought we were running out of concrete actions that countries could take. In the first two summits, a number of countries agreed to eliminate or reduce their holdings of weapons usable materials. But we were really starting to scrape the bottom of the barrel in terms of additional countries that were willing to take such steps. And so, for example, South Africa or Belarus and other countries made it clear that they were not willing to take very significant steps on nuclear security. So the Iran agreement was really a surprise, and it really grew out of the surprise election of Rouhani as president in June of 2013. And even though they're very difficult negotiations, on paper I think the agreement is very significant, and as I said, if it actually works, it will be an important step. Now let me talk about there are three arguments out there for why the Iran deal might help to trigger progress on the broader Prague agenda. Let me talk about each of those in turn. One has to do with U.S.-Russian relations, one has to do with the sort of regional proliferation and arms control, and the third has to do with the broader international nonproliferation regime. So on the U.S.-Russian front, Foreign Minister Lavrov, Russian Foreign Minister Lavrov, has made a clever argument that since the Iran deal solves the threat from Iran, the U.S. can afford to dispense with its missile defense program in Europe, which, as I said, is one of the stumbling blocks between further U.S.-Russian arms control. I think it's a clever argument, but it's not very convincing. Because first, as I said, we don't really know whether this Iran nuclear deal solves the problem, and we won't know for 10 or 15 years. So that hardly is strong grounds for stopping the missile defense program in Europe. And in any event, even if the nuclear issue is resolved, the Iranians have made it very clear that they're going to continue with their ballistic missile program, having just recently conducted two tests in violation of current UN Security Council resolutions. And even if you did solve the Iran problem, we still have North Korea, which we're really not in a very strong position to solve, maybe slow down, but not address. And it's the North Korean threat that is the main driver for our national missile defense program, which I think in many ways is a much more significant threat from Russia's standpoint than our missile defense program in Europe. Just as an aside, I'm often asked by people from Korea whether the Iran deal might serve as a model for North Korea. And I always say, I'm sorry, but the situations are just completely different. And our leverage against North Korea, whether it's economic sanctions or military threats or diplomatic sanctions, is just not comparable to what we were able to employ against Iran. And in any event, North Korea already has nuclear weapons, whereas Iran doesn't. So rolling back a program is much more difficult than stopping one. So, you know, at the end of the day, it doesn't seem to me that the Iran deal actually removes the main stumbling block for U.S.-Russia arms control. I've always thought that there may be a time in the future when the Russians are willing to accept lower numbers, when they have greater confidence in the survivability of their strategic forces. And of course, the Russians are engaged in a long-term modernization program that basically would be to move their fixed, to retire their fixed big heavy ICBMs and their fixed silos to road mobile ICBMs and to deploy a new class of submarines. At that point, when they have more confidence that the forces are survivable, they might be willing, I think, to agree to lower numbers, even if we have a limited missile defense program. But we're probably many years away from the Russian modernization program reaching that point. And in the meantime, I imagine the U.S. will have to continue with its long-term program to, you know, to modernize the triad, even though it's many years away. But we're just now beginning that process, and I think it's very unlikely that President Obama or any president is going to agree to unilateral steps to limit the U.S. The U.S. modernization program, both because we don't want to give away bargaining chips that we would ultimately want to use in a deal with the Russians, but also just given the political tensions between Washington and Moscow, it's pretty hard to justify taking unilateral steps to limit the U.S. program. So secondly, let me talk about the impact of the Iran deal on regional, that is to say Middle East, pressures for proliferation and efforts to promote regional arms control. Now, optimists argue that the Iran deal may help to put energy into long-stalled, moribund efforts to at least hold discussions to establish a Middle East nuclear weapons-free zone, or a free zone of weapons of mass destruction. Unfortunately, I think it's just the opposite in terms of Israel's willingness to participate in such discussions. And of course, any discussion of a nuclear weapons-free zone in the Middle East would directly impact Israel, since Israel is the only country that has a nuclear capability. And ultimately, would such a regional arms control arrangement would require Israel to give up its nuclear capability. But my friends in the Israeli government, especially in the Prime Minister's office, they, in their view, they think the Iran nuclear deal guarantees that Iran will get nuclear weapons in 10 or 15 years, when all the physical constraints on Iran's program are lifted. And so from their standpoint, instead of engaging in a diplomatic process that would increase pressure on Israel to give up its nuclear capabilities, they're much more focused on how can Israel build up its nuclear capabilities for the day when, in their view, Iran has nuclear weapons. Now, as I said, we don't know in 15 years whether that's right or not, but the you know, perception and calculation in Tel Aviv is against any constraint and much more in thinking about what they can do to establish a more robust deterrent. On the other hand, I'm not sure I agree with the pessimists who argue that the Arab countries will try to emulate what the nuclear deal with Iran allows Iran to have, which is a full-scale civil fuel cycle program, giving it an inherent nuclear weapons option. I think it's true that a lot of Arab countries would like to have a nuclear weapons option, and they're also very skeptical about the effectiveness of the Iran nuclear deal. But the Arab countries are pretty substantially limited in terms of their capability. The three Arab countries who have most recently sought to build nuclear weapons, Iraq, Syria, and Libya, don't even exist anymore as a consequence of the Arab Spring. And I think it's very unlikely in the near term that they will reconstitute themselves as effective nation states. So that limits, obviously, very significantly their ability to have a nuclear weapons program. And the other Arab countries are very limited either by financial limits, like Egypt, or limits in terms of skilled and trained personnel, like Saudi Arabia. So basically, without substantial external assistance, I think none of the Arab countries are really in a strong position to develop a fuel cycle program. And just like in the case of Iran, they're not going to get that external assistance from any of the established nuclear suppliers because no one will sell either reprocessing or enrichment technology to the Middle East. They'll have to get it through black market or unconventional suppliers, Pakistan in the case of in the case of Iran, North Korea in the case of Syria. And that's something that bears watching. But without that external assistance, I don't see the Middle East sort of rapidly, you know, leading to further proliferation of nuclear weapons. So finally, let me talk about the impact of the Iran deal on the international regime, the non-proliferation system. Now, many or some people have suggested that we should try to generalize some of the attractive features of the nuclear deal and try to apply it more broadly to other non-nuclear weapon states under the international treaties. And there are some very attractive features in the nuclear deal with Iran that we would like to see duplicated. There are, you know, there are specified limits and bans on certain activities related to nuclear weapons development. There's a system that sets up a timetable to grant IAEA access to suspicious sites and activities. All of these would be great if we could make them a general feature of the international safeguard system. But unfortunately, I think the non-nuclear weapon states led by the more radical countries in the non-aligned movement, like Mexico, Brazil, South Africa, they're in no mood to accept any additional restrictions on their peaceful nuclear programs, in part because some of them want to keep the system as weak as possible so that they have at least an option available in the future to develop a nuclear weapons option should they believe it's necessary. And that's especially true, I think, of countries in the Middle East like Egypt, who've always opposed any additional measures to strengthen safeguards or limit access to nuclear technology. And in part because I think there's a genuine feeling among the non-aligned countries that the whole disarmament process has slowed down or stopped completely, and that unless they see movement on nuclear disarmament, the nuclear weapon states taking things to move in the direction of nuclear disarmament, they're not prepared to agree to additional restrictions on their nuclear activities. And the truth is the trend is away from nuclear disarmament. I mean, all of the nuclear states in one form or another are modernizing. And in the case of Asia, they're not only modernizing, they're also enlarging their programs, China, India, Pakistan, even North Korea. And there's not very much that the U.S. can do to stop that trend. So, you know, I promised you this would not be a very positive speech. So, you know, to conclude, I do think the Iran deal, you know, could be a very significant step, very important if it works. and obviously our focus should be now on making sure that it does work. But I'm not sure that it really does very much, at least at this point, to jumpstart the rest of the Prague Agenda, which, as I said, are blocked by a variety of other factors that are essentially unrelated to Iran. Thank you.
Who'd like to start off the first question?
I'm the guy that always asks the first question. Most of the questions are off base, so be prepared. It's a methodology.
No questions are off base.
Okay, okay. It's a methodology question.
Yeah.
Hearing what you've described, I would hope somebody somewhere has developed a set of, let's say, 50 scenarios of how things could unfold. Does anybody in your on your planet work at that level of structure? I'm not even saying that they should.
Right. I don't know how systematic it is, but I think people are very aware of the different ways in which the Iran nuclear deal could unravel. And I would start, in a very general sense, by thinking of things that could go wrong within the four corners of the agreement, and then secondly, things that could go wrong outside the agreement itself. Because as you know, the agreement doesn't regulate a wide range of Iranian behavior that we object to, whether it's ballistic missile activity or support for Hezbollah or so forth. Let me just talk about the first category within the four corners of the agreement. I mean, I think there will be tension on this agreement both from what the Iranians might do and what we might do. In terms of Iranian actions, they could, you know, I think in the near term they're likely to carry out the nuclear steps necessary to get sanctions relief. Most people believe that they have such a strong interest in getting the economic benefits that they're not likely to cheat or renege on the agreement in this early process. But I think the concern is that over some period of time, maybe a couple of years, when they feel they're in a stronger position, having been able to revive their economy, and if they calculate that there'll be less attention paid to their program, they might be tempted to resume some of the secret nuclear activities, including efforts to build covert enrichment facilities that they've done in the past. Or they might just at some point renege on the deal. And whether they choose to renege on the deal will depend in part on what we do. I mean, the Iranians have made it clear that from their standpoint, any new sanctions we impose are contrary to the spirit of the agreement. On the other hand, we've made it clear that the deal only applies to nuclear-related sanctions, and that we will continue to be quite free and willing to impose sanctions on Iran for other behavior they carry out that we don't like, whether it's for human rights or counterterrorism or ballistic missiles or whatever. So there's a real tension in the agreement, and maybe this administration is going to be very careful. I think they are being very careful not to take actions against Iran until the nuclear agreement is actually implemented. But the next U.S. administration could be much less sympathetic to this agreement and much more willing to run the risk of undermining it by opposing additional sanctions. We know Congress would, there are many in Congress who would support that. So I think it's conceivable to me that the deal could fall apart by actions either in Tehran or in Washington.
Thanks for that presentation, Gary. What's your assessment of the results of the IAEA investigation of the prior weapon development activities in Iran, where they concluded that even after 2003, Iran continues to show an interest in developing nuclear weapons? Does that change your judgment about the value of the overall agreement?
Well, you know, we made a fundamental decision in the negotiations that we were going to basically give Iran a pass on its past activities. We were not going to require Iran to genuinely cooperate with the IAEA to acknowledge and then to fill out the details of what they did. And that was just a fundamental choice that was made in order to get a deal. And the negotiators thought they couldn't get an agreement unless they gave Iran a pass. Whether that was a correct judgment or not, I mean, it's hard for me to say, not having been in the room. It's a difficult decision because it means that the agreement is built on a falsehood, which is the Iranians never had an interest in pursuing nuclear weapons, which we all know to be untrue, although that's important to the Iranian political narrative. I thought the IAEA report was laudatory in the sense that, and I was very happy that Amano did tell the truth. He did say that Iran had a nuclear weapons research and development program. So I thought it was good that that assessment be out there. I think what is more controversial is the decision of the Board of Governors to then pass a resolution that says the investigation is closed. I would have preferred that the resolution make clear that if additional information becomes available, or if the Iranians themselves wish to provide additional information, the agency should reopen that investigation. But obviously there was an agreement done, and Khamenei said this publicly, that you know, unless the file was closed, investigation finished, that we wouldn't harass the Iranians anymore about their past activities, you know, they would not go ahead with the agreement. So that's, you know, part of the, there were several in this agreement, there were several very difficult and controversial concessions we made, and this was one of them. But in terms of the, you know, details of Iran's program, I do think we have a pretty good sense of what they were doing and how far they got, mainly because of a fortuitous event. I mean, we were able to, you know, obtain a lot of detailed information about their activities. So I do think we have a pretty good understanding. The big question mark is how, you know, to what extent we will be able in the future to detect any activities if the Iranians resume them. I'm much more confident in our ability to detect efforts to build covert facilities to process fissile material. I'm much less confident in our ability to detect, you know, weaponization activities, which are always harder to detect because they involve a smaller number of people and smaller facilities and so forth, fewer signatures. But still, I think we've been pretty successful in terms of good intelligence capability against Iran. And I think we and other countries, Israel, UK, France, and so forth, are going to continue to invest resources to monitor Iran's nuclear program because, frankly, nobody believes this nuclear deal reflects any fundamental decision on Iran's part to give up its many decades quest for a nuclear weapons capability. They've made a tactical decision that they need to accept temporary limits and additional monitoring in order to get sanctions relief. But they haven't changed their mind about why nuclear weapons are in their interest for strategic reasons. And part of the, I mean, in a way, it works to our advantage that they failed to cooperate with the IAEA, because it means nobody is going to be willing to assume that the Iranians have genuinely made a, you know, decision to stop the program, and therefore we can afford to, not continue to monitor very closely. And also, just one other little detail: the way the agreement is structured, many of the restrictions are the fundamental sanctions are not you know, removed until 8 years after. After adoption day, or when the IAEA reaches a so-called broader conclusion that all nuclear material in Iran is for peaceful purposes, whichever comes first. The good thing about the Iranians not cooperating is that the IAEA is not going to be able to reach that broader conclusion for at least 8 years. So at least we get the benefit of the full period of restriction in terms of the sanctions.
Thank you. Let me pursue that one more step.
Sure.
Does this possibly then lead Iran to a tacit understanding that routine noncompliance is going to be tolerated, given that we have given them this buy here, that they launched two ballistic missiles in violation of sanctions, and so that they may well stonewall inspectors who seek to enforce the deal over the next decade?
So the implicit, I mean, the deal that we think we have with Iran is it will give you a pass on what you did before. And we're not going to require, this agreement's not going to touch non-nuclear activities like ballistic missiles and other things. But on the core nuclear constraints, including limits and monitoring, that's what we expect you to live up with. My understanding is that so far the Iranians naturally have tried to see whether they can water down some of the limits on their nuclear steps they have to take. For example, the Iranians have a very large amount of extremely low enriched uranium, and they've said, you know, do we really have to get rid of this or blend it down? It's such a, you know, it's so close to natural that, you know, won't you allow us to count it as natural? And my understanding is that we've said no. You know, you're required under the agreement, you know, to, you know, have only 300 kilograms of low enriched uranium, and you have to actually comply with that. Same, I don't know if you read in the papers, but they're also having trouble getting rid of their 20% enriched because the facility to process that is broken. And, you know, I think they said, well, you know, we're not trying to, you know, cause a problem here, but we just physically can't get rid of the stuff. And I think we've said, well, you have to, and apparently we've tried to, you know, mediate some agreement with Kazakhstan to hold the material for some period of time. But I think your question is a good one, because, you know, the Iranians will test. I mean, they're going to test. That's what they do, and it's perfectly understandable. And, you know, the U.S. and its allies have to be in a position to push back on those core nuclear constraints, because that's what this agreement is built on. Hey, John.
A couple weeks ago, Bill Perry talked about his book where he reviews, you know, his accomplishments and how he feels about things. And he's done some really interesting things. But he did end up the conversation, or at least his notes, being fairly pessimistic. He said a lot of what he got done through START and all that sort of stuff seems to be coming undone with, you know, especially with the Chinese and the Russians expanding and upgrading their arsenals. I'm confused about the Chinese part, because right. On one hand, you know, people talk about them having a limited supply of, you know, missiles on rails that, you know, give them a certain retaliatory situation. Right. Whereas, on the other hand, they're building more stuff, and why? Is it just projecting right. power, or why?
So, of course, I don't know the answer to that, but I'll tell you what I think the Chinese calculation is. I think the Chinese, unlike the Russians, don't think of a stable strategic balance in terms of warfighting capacity. I mean, the Russians are still very much, when they do their calculations about how many forces they need, they still base that on the old Cold War, you know, calculation of, you know, if we launched a strike out of the blue at their nuclear forces, how many remaining warheads would they need to overcome our missile defense system in order to deter us from launching the first strike? I mean, that's how they think of the nuclear balance. I think the Chinese don't think of it that way. I think they do have a minimum deterrent strategy, and they believe that if they have the, you know, capacity to destroy some number of American cities, I don't know what that number is, but let's say a dozen or two, I think they believe that is sufficient for deterrence. And I think what they're doing is consistent with that. I mean, for years, the Chinese, I'm amazed for how many years the Chinese were willing to content to have a very limited, vulnerable strategic force, which, you know, frankly, would probably, you know, had a, you know, very high ability for us to you know, preemptively destroy. And I think they decided some time ago, you know, probably more than a decade ago, that they were going to gradually move to a more survivable strategic capability, both submarines and road mobile ICBMs. I honestly, I mean, the Chinese, if they wanted to, of course they could deploy thousands of warheads. I don't think they want to. I don't think they see that as necessary. Their big focus is on, you know, build up to their conventional forces, especially Navy and Air Force, and because they see that as a much more usable, you know, military instrument than nuclear weapons. So that's my take on the Chinese. But no Chinese official has said that to me. That's just my interpretation.
Thanks again for coming out and giving this very interesting talk. So for years, there's been this sort of fundamental tension in U.S. nonproliferation policy. On the one hand, we've attempted to dissuade countries from developing fuel cycle capabilities through the NSG and through our 123 agreements. On the other hand, you've got Article 4 of the NPT, peaceful uses, and the non-aligned movement makes a lot of hay about underlining this right, this inalienable right that they perceive that they have. How does the deal with Iran basically underlying the right of Iran to pursue fuel cycle activities, well, enrichment, not reprocessing, factor into sort of the non-proliferation policy of the U.S. moving forward?
I think it's a very good question. I mean, let me start by saying that there's always been a tension in U.S. policy. We, in general, since the Carter administration, have sought to discourage the spread of civilian fuel cycle technology because it has military uses. But in practice, we've always made exceptions, right? We made an exception for Japan and Europe under the Reagan administration. Under the Bush administration, we made an exception for Brazil. And now under the Obama administration, we've made an exception for Iran. In other words, we've recognized reality as opposed to pursuing a policy that was, that you know, could not be achieved, because we don't think we can roll back or prevent, in all cases, civilian fuel cycle. On the other hand, I think we have to acknowledge that the Iran deal weakens our ability to make a case, especially to other Middle East countries, that they shouldn't pursue a fuel cycle program as part of their nuclear power program. I wouldn't want to be the diplomat to go into Saudi Arabia and say, you know, you're planning on building 20 power reactors, that's great, you don't need any enrichment. You know, don't worry, you can rely on the international market. I think that's true, but it's not going to be a very strong case if we've essentially accepted that Iran can build an industrial scale enrichment program after 15 years. As I said, I think our more likely constraint with respect to the Arab countries is their limits on capacity, rather than the strength of our arguments about what their rights are under the NPT.
John Futterman, recently retired from the lab, visiting scientist now. With regard to Iran's accepting this pause in its nuclear program, has anybody given consideration that maybe they're doing that in order to let their missile program catch up?
I think their missile program is already much more advanced and has been much more advanced than their nuclear weapons capability for years. Keep in mind they bought their missile program off the shelf from North Korea, including not only production facilities, but the missiles themselves. And so, that argument doesn't seem to be consistent with the actual status of their capability. You know, they've had missiles capable of launching nuclear weapons for, 20 years. Now, I think they will continue to build their missile program. I've never been one to think that that is necessarily a telltale indication of a nuclear weapons intent, because a country like Iran, which has no air force, doesn't have a very capable air force compared to even other countries in the region, for them, missiles do serve some conventional purpose. So I could imagine within the IRGC and the Iranian military, the argument is being made that, even if we put our nuclear program on the shelf for 15 years, and what we do in 15 years is still uncertain, we still have an important, military need to have more accurate surface-to-surface missiles with conventional warheads. And I think that's a pretty compelling argument, as long as they don't really have, much of an Air Force capacity. And for a long time now, even when the arms embargo is lifted, it'll take them many years to catch up with even the Saudis, much less the Israelis.
In the sense that, the United States sort of removed one obstacle to Iran's achieving regional hegemony in the Middle East, namely we knocked down Iraq, and an effective Iraq has yet to stand up. Is anybody in the administration sort of thinking ahead to how the current Sunni-Shia civil war is shaping up, and how we can try to shape some sort of order in that region that's more congenial to U.S. interests?
Yeah. So, it's a great question, and obviously the Obama administration has been unable to come up with an effective strategy to deal with the chaos and turmoil in the Middle East. I frankly suspect that no American administration can come up with an effective strategy. I mean, in part because I think there are very significant limits on the public's willingness to commit additional large ground forces, not only to fight, but to occupy and restore order. So I think the tools we have available to deal with the chaos in the Middle East are very, very limited. And we shouldn't accept, it's not like normal diplomacy, right? You have countries falling apart, you have mass movements, people in the streets, civil wars, these very deep-seated religious and ethnic conflicts. The U.S. really can't do much to solve those problems. We have to try to manage it as best we can, but I suspect the next administration is going to find the Middle East just as frustrating as the Obama administration. And some people argue that what we're witnessing in the Middle East is sort of the start of something comparable to the 30 years war in Europe, you know, between Catholics and Protestants, which, you know, killed a large number of the population, you know, destroyed or really damaged state formation throughout Western Europe. And that just may be the fate of the Middle East now. But in terms of Iran's sort of, you know, hegemony, I don't worry about that, because I don't think, I mean, I think Iran as a Persian Shia power has very limited ability to dominate the Middle East, which is primarily an Arab-Sunni countries. And there are enough powerful countries left standing, even in the wake of the Arab Spring, Turkey, Saudi, Egypt, Israel. So I think I think Iran's ability to dominate the region is very limited. I'm not sure that I would, I mean, I do think you're right about Iraq. I think from Iran's standpoint, that has been a clear win. Which unfortunately we facilitated. And I think both Bush and Obama bear some blame for Bush for going in and Obama for coming out in ways that, that gave Iran opportunities. I'm not sure if we look back in history whether the Iranian adventures in Syria and Yemen will actually turn out to be very positive from their standpoint. In Yemen, I think it's been demonstrated that they have no capacity to support their allies, or at least nominal allies, the Houthis. I mean, their efforts to arm them have been blocked, including by the U.S. And the Saudis and Saudi allies have been able to fight, to bomb and intervene, you know, without any, interference from Iran at all. So I'm not sure Yemen. I wouldn't count Yemen as a great victory for Iran. And as I say, Syria is just up in the air. I mean, I was reading the other day that, you know, in part because of casualties, the Iranians are starting to remove their forces from Syria. So the judgment is just out on Syria. But I don't worry about Iran, you know, somehow being the dominant power. The reason why they look strong is because of American mistakes and because of the Arab Spring has collapsed Arab powers. It's not because of their own inherent capabilities.
Let me change the topic a little bit toward Asia in the next few decades. There seems to be a strong movement, sort of below the radar, I think, to develop plutonium reprocessing capabilities. First, Rakkasho in Japan, which is briefly delayed, and China penning an agreement with Areva to build a copy of Rakkasho,
yes,
both of which would have 8 metric ton plutonium capabilities a year, mm-hmm, ostensibly for use in breeder reactors, which neither country has successfully built and are not like nobody has really successfully built, including France, mm-hmm, for the next 50 years. And so we see enormous stockpiles potentially of plutonium building up in both countries, and then South Korea looking at that and saying, mm-hmm, we want pyroprocessing and to renegotiate our agreement.
Right.
And so we have huge weapons usable plutonium stockpiles, mm-hmm, being accreted with no path out, mm-hmm, for them. It seems like an extremely unstable situation, and perhaps the intent is something other than energy. Why and what should we do?
So I agree with you that we have a strong national interest in trying to prevent or at least delay the development of large-scale civil reprocessing facilities in East Asia, where, of course, the nuclear energy programs, except for Japan, are booming. I mean, I think in the case of Korea, I give the administration high marks for renegotiating the U.S.-South Korea civil nuclear cooperation agreement so that we didn't grant prior consent. We continue to have approval on a case-by-case basis for U.S. origin nuclear material. Although we are working with the Koreans on pyroprocessing. And I think we just have to recognize that, you know, as South Korea has developed, has become a very advanced nuclear power, they're going to want to at least have the option open for breeders in the long-term future. I mean, nobody expects, at least I don't expect breeders to be a commercially viable technology for decades. But I can understand why countries that have advanced nuclear programs would want to continue to do research and development. And as you say, that inherently gives them a nuclear weapons option. Of course, Japan already has a nuclear weapons option, and they've had one for years and years. They've got tons of plutonium on hand. Now, you talked about Rokosho. I think that's a very interesting issue. You said it was temporarily delayed, but it's been temporarily delayed for years now. And I wouldn't be at all surprised if that delay continues for another 21 years.
They realized they were going to open it during the nuclear security summit.
Right.
Which kind of caused them to delay.
So the latest I've heard is that they delayed until some additional safety and security reviews or environmental, you know, whatever, which is like, well, but it's 2 years away. So I do think, I mean, that's what I was told. I haven't been there recently, but somebody who follows this very closely. Yeah. Oh, well, it's an industrial scale reprocessing facility, civil reprocessing facility, which the Japanese have built years ago and has had many technical and political problems.
By the way, Manju is shut down now. They
right.
Close.
Yep.
So there is literally no path out.
Yes.
Probably
that's
for
right.
50
years. Yep. We've been very, when I was in the White House, we were very delicate about how we addressed this issue from Japan because on one hand, we have to recognize that since the Reagan administration, we have given Japan prior consent and we have not, openly and actively tried to discourage them from, pursuing reprocessing. But we did work with them very closely on nuclear security, and the Japanese have agreed to the idea that they won't accumulate additional separated plutonium without having some way to use it as MOX or as fuel for breeders. So I think we have a very strong technical case that there really isn't any need for them to separate any additional plutonium. And of course, in the wake of Fukushima, the public attitude toward nuclear power, not just reprocessing, but nuclear power writ large is very skeptical and hostile. So I think with some gentle nudging and quiet diplomacy from the U.S., I think we can continue to fend off opening of Rokosho. With respect to the Chinese, again, I think we have to recognize that as a country that seeks to deploy very large numbers of nuclear power reactors, they're going to want to have that option open.
But it makes no sense.
It makes no sense now. And I think the Chinese are not likely to. I think they'll buy a piece of Areva so they have access to the technology. They bought a big chunk of the British nuclear power system. I think the Chinese will want to have the technology, but I think they make calculations in their nuclear power program on the basis of, basically safety, security, and, economic calculation, and there's no economic reason for them to engage in reprocessing now. If the Chinese, that's the risk. The risk is that if Japan goes ahead, then China is likely to go ahead and it'll be more difficult for us to restrain South Korea. If the Chinese go ahead, I'm told by my Japanese friends, they will have to go ahead and again we'll have trouble with South Korea. So there's a connection among all three of these countries. But I think we have a reasonable chance because we have such a strong argument on technical economic grounds and it just doesn't make sense. And in terms of the military motive, if the Chinese need additional plutonium for nuclear weapons, I have a feeling they have other ways of producing it. They don't need to use, a civil fuel cycle program as cover. So, same with enrichment. They have unsafeguarded enrichment facilities. So I don't find that a compelling argument that the Chinese, are, pursuing civil fuel cycle for nuclear weapons purposes, because I think they have alternative means to get.
They have alternative means, but it depends on how big they want to make
their. Yes, you're absolutely right.
Right.
That's right. And I, as I said earlier, when John asked, I don't think the Chinese are looking to match us number for number. I think they've decided that that's a waste of money.
I hope you're right.
I hope I'm right, too. We'll find out.
I'm just curious, Gary. We've talked about lots of the most of the major, all of the major players, but there's another one that I'm curious what your view is, and that's India.
Mm-hmm.
Where, I mean, do you have views on where you see India today in terms of energy
right.
and proliferation, and
yeah.
and where they might be going, and how they might play in this whole game?
Sure. So, on the energy front, the Indians are committed to expand nuclear power, but unfortunately, they really have botched the implementation of the U.S.-India Peaceful Nuclear Cooperation Agreement. And I think it was not the intent of the government. I mean, I think the previous government, genuinely wanted to put in place a national system for liabilities that would have made it possible for U.S. companies and other Western companies to bid on nuclear power reactors. But in India's political culture, for a variety of reasons, I mean, in part because of the Bhopal disaster, in part because the previous government was very weak, they were just simply not able to pass a law on liability that our companies and other Western companies were comfortable with. I know that Modi, Prime Minister Modi, who's much stronger, in a much stronger political position, would like to fix that. I know they're working on it. But it's tough, and I don't know enough to be able to judge whether they're going to be able to correct their current law on liability so that U.S. and other and French and Russian companies are willing to proceed. I hope they do. On the nuclear weapons front, I mean, there's just no question that India is intends to develop a strategic deterrent against China. And the Indians, they think of themselves as a great power, and they would like to have if not a triad, at least a, very robust, strategic capability, including land-based and sea-based ICBMs. I mean, Neil Jock can tell you more about this than I can, but I think the Indian program is moving slowly in the usual Indian fashion, but I think it's inexorable. I mean, and we're not going to do anything to stop it. So I think that in 20 years or whatever, the Indians will, they already have a very limited capacity against Beijing. But I think they will develop, a more of a strategic deterrent against China. The Chinese, curiously, don't worry too much about the Indians. That's a lesser included case. The Chinese worry is about the U.S., of course. And the Chinese will expand their program so that they're comfortable that it has the minimum deterrent I talk about. So, I mean, it's unfortunate. It's just the dynamics. The North Koreans will expand their program. We will build up our missile defense, and that will lead the Chinese to build up their strategic forces. I don't see any way to break that chain, because I can't figure out a way to stop the North Koreans. As long as that regime is in power, I don't see any way to stop them. We have no military option and no diplomatic option. We don't have any sanctions option, and we can constrain and limit and delay what they do, but we can't solve the problem.
That was sort of a parochial question about the role of the laboratories in meeting
yeah.
the challenges of the security environment. So, I'm struck by how many times you've framed the problems in front of us in a longer-term perspective. The Iran question not really going to settle itself for another decade or two. The prospects for nuclear arms control with Russia, really something that's not likely to be settled until New Start mm-hmm. expires in 2021 or 2026. Long time to wait. China on a certain trajectory. India on a certain trajectory. Chaos in the Middle East for a long time to come.
Right.
This seems like it ought to be a moment of opportunity
mm-hmm.
to, after a period of a lot of strategic change to get our act together and point ourselves to some useful new work. On the other hand, it's difficult surveying that landscape to see some significant new activity bearing on the mission space of the laboratories. Mm-hmm. In the 1990s, the cooperative threat reduction agenda came to the fore and provided a whole lot of work for this kind of organization. Mm-hmm. Nuclear material security endeavor. None of this is really going to go away. Well, mm-hmm. cooperative threat reduction with the Russians has gone away.
Yeah.
But the effort to cooperate with others to reduce nuclear mm-hmm. dangers will not go away.
Right.
But is there a growth stock out there? Is there a problem that sits in this emerging security landscape that the technical community can bring some new tools to? Or is the message for the technical community, by and large, steady as you go on what you're doing? You got a broad and diverse portfolio. You got to work all the different strains, and there's not a new growth stock.
It's a very good question. I haven't given it much thought, so forgive me if I'm just speaking off the cuff. I don't, off the top of my head, I can't think of any huge new area for the design labs for Livermore and Los Alamos. I mean, I do think we have a fundamental problem with the production infrastructure. I mean, Oak Ridge, for example, and I honestly don't know whether this country's capable of coming up with the money necessary to repair the production infrastructure and to start down the road of modernizing the triad. I mean, we're talking about massive budget requirements, and I honestly don't know where the money's going to come from. I mean, one of the reasons why I would like to revive the main reason I'd like to revive arms control with the Russians is because we think we need to save ourselves billions of dollars and use that money for other military purposes that are probably more important, or for civilian purposes. But I think the labs are going to continue to have an important role in terms of, I mean, coming from Z Division, first of all, the value of having a community of people who genuinely understand nuclear weapons, I think, is extremely important because, as I said, we're going to see an expansion and modernization of nuclear weapons programs around the world. So that's very important. And then in terms of maintaining the U.S. nuclear arsenal is going to continue to be a long-term requirement. Even though I would love to not spend a lot of money modernizing our U.S. nuclear forces, I just think we're probably condemned to do that for the foreseeable future.
This is a follow-up question to Brad's. Do you think the IAEA is up to implementing the Iran deal, and could they use some help? And is the administration thinking about it?
So I have great confidence in the IAEA's ability to monitor declared facilities and activities, and that's what we depend on them for. So at the declared nuclear sites in Iran that the IAEA will have equipment and inspectors in place, I think it's extraordinarily unlikely that Iran will cheat there because the risk of being detected, any significant diversion, is extraordinarily high. So, and that's what we want the IAEA to do. In terms of the IAEA's ability to detect clandestine activities, it's very weak. I mean, I can't think of a good case where the IAEA has actually detected clandestine activities. They don't have an intelligence service, right? I mean, they depend upon information from member states. So the primary burden for the most likely cheating route, which is clandestine activity, is not the IAEA. The primary burden is CIA, Mossad, MI6, and the French intelligence service, the DGSE. So it's really on us to monitor compliance with the Iran deal and help the IAEA do their job with information, money, technical support, seconded personnel, and so forth.
Gary, thanks so much for your time. I guess more generally, you talked about constrain, limit, and delay proliferation and perhaps expansion of stockpiles around the country, around the globe. So the Prague Agenda has a lot of pieces to it. And some people hear path to zero,
perhaps not in my lifetime, they don't hear, but path to zero. Some people look at a closer term, global zero. But it also, Prague Agenda included bilateral reduction between superpower stockpiles, you know, and then it also looked at increased stability. So there's a tension between a dream of global zero, perhaps, mm-hmm. and the reality of arms control that's achievable. So is there a path for achievable arms control for other steps, bilaterally between the U.S. and Russia, for stockpiles by up to one-third? Mm-hmm. Or do we move to a multilateral in the P5? What's the path forward, and what do you see as the next step forward?
So I think a multilateral nuclear arms control agreement is not practical for the foreseeable future, because there are just too many differences among the recognized nuclear weapon states. And if you include, you know, the declared nuclear weapon states, India and Pakistan, as well as the five, U.S., Russia, U.K., France, and China, there's just such diversity that I don't see how you can possibly come up with an agreement. I mean, we wouldn't accept equity. The Russians wouldn't accept equity among those seven countries. And I don't see any of them being willing to accept a legally binding restriction on their nuclear programs that puts them at a disadvantage with each other and with the rest of the group. So I don't think you can have something. I mean, there's, you know, once in history, one time I know of, there was something called the, you know, the Washington Naval Convention. You remember that? I just don't see how it's possible to duplicate that in the nuclear field, where countries, you know, accept a, you know, sort of ratio. So, you know, but I do think in theory there's a path forward for another U.S.-Russia agreement that would be at least a one-third reduction. But as I said, I don't think that's going to be possible until the Russians have more confidence in the survivability of their forces. And that means some period of time, years, of them, you know, retiring the big heavy Cold War ICBMs and moving to the road mobile systems, and they're still having trouble with their new submarines. So the sort of irony here is that modernization makes arms control possible, I mean, in terms of reductions. And I'd like to at least have a chance to talk to the Russians at some point in the future about structuring forces. I mean, it'd be my sort of dream, you know, proposal would be for both sides not to have any fixed silo ICBMs. You know, but as I said, that's not going to be possible for the Russians until a smaller percentage of their forces are invested in the fixed systems. And, you know, I mean, unlike us, where we don't really need the ICBMs for our strategic deterrent because the subs are so capable. But the Russians are just, they don't have that luxury now.
So if I go back to Jim Miller's PhD dissertation, he requires a mix of 50-50 between fixed ICBMs and mobile ICBMs. So does the U.S. need more mobile ICBMs or at all?
I would be comfortable without having any, but the Russians are going to have some. So then you get into a parity question. And how do you, I mean, the Russians cannot depend on submarines the way we do. So you might have, you know, you'd have to, that would be part of a negotiation, right, is whether we would be compensated by having a bigger sub force, or whether, you know, we would have to have some mobile systems to match theirs. But that's so far in the future. We don't have to worry about that problem now. I mean, years away.
Another methodology question, and especially now that I realize you're a Z division kind of guy. I work in counterterrorism. Please don't laugh. But a lot of what I talk about and some of us talk about is, well, you've got to build an adversary model. So here's the question. If really smart people, Z division type or others, got together, could they build an adversary model that would have any value added for how China makes decisions, how Russia makes decisions, how India? Is this just a hopeless cause, don't even try, or is there value there?
Oh, I think it's extraordinarily important to understand how other countries see the world and how they make decisions. And that, that depends in part on, you know, deep knowledge of their culture and history and politics, and it depends on very good intelligence. It depends on a lot of interaction. I mean, I learn much more about strategic culture by meeting with Pakistanis and Iranians and North Koreans and Russians than by reading about it in a book. But I think it's extraordinarily important. I mean, you can't conduct effective foreign policy without understanding friends and allies and adversaries. I mean, it's the only way to be effective.
Yes, I have a question about arms control and that. The significance if the Russian INF non-compliance persists in terms of creating sort of a wink-nod attitude about arms control overall, and not just with Russia, but with others as well.
Yep.
So what do you see as the pathway to bring them back onto track, or how significant it is if this continues unresolved?
Well, I think it's very significant for the reason that you said, that it casts doubt about the the reliability of the Russians and the efficacy of agreements if they're violated without being corrected. I don't think it's very consequential from a military standpoint. I mean, there's no doubt the Russians have violated the treaty by testing, ground-launched cruise missiles that are a violation of the treaty. There's no doubt about that. But as far as I know, they haven't deployed those systems. And as far as I know, there's nothing that the INF treaty prevents us from doing that we want to do. If there was, I think we'd be perfectly in our rights to withdraw from the treaty and, and to deploy systems that are currently prohibited. The reason why we stay in the treaty is because, A, it doesn't limit us from doing anything we want to do anyway, and, B, for purely political reasons. I mean, our European allies like the INF treaty. I think the Russians would be very happy if we would withdraw from it, because then they could blame us. We would be happy if they would withdraw from it, so we could blame them. But neither Moscow nor Washington wants to incur the blame for killing the treaty. So I think we could easily, the current situation with the Russians in violation could last for a long time. I mean, remember under the ABM treaty, the Russians violated the ABM treaty for, I don't know, was it decades? And the treaty was still in force. So it's an unhappy fact of life that these treaties can be violated in ways that I would argue are relatively marginal to their central limits and survive that way.
Let me put a question to you in your capacity as a frequent director of research. Are we as a community generating the right insights into the kind of security environment that you've described us as moving into, firstly? And secondly, you look around the room and you actually see a fair number of people who don't have gray hair, which is an accomplishment for us.
Right.
But how do you think we're doing on that problem?
Yeah. So that's the most important thing. I mean, as people like me, start thinking fondly about retirement, I'm very impressed with the number and quality of young people that I see, well, first of all, at the Belfer Center as pre- and postdoc fellows who are interested in international security and specifically nuclear issues. So, and not just Americans. I mean, I think maybe it's not as easy to do here as it is at a university, but I'm very happy that the Kennedy School is extremely international. I mean, we always have students from, Russia, Europe, China, even Pakistan. And I think it's important that because it just can't just be an American preoccupation, right? It's important that we have educated people around the world that we can interact with and which can influence or serve in their governments, just as we are trying to train people to influence and serve in our governments. One specific thing to mention, as I do worry a little bit about I think we still have a weakness in regional studies. I mean, now that Russia has become a hot issue again, I've been kind of looking around and there aren't many Russia experts around, except those that have gray hair. Everybody become a China expert. And I think we're still pretty weak on Neil's one of the few people who's a real expert on Pakistan. We don't have a deep bench when it comes to Pakistan or India, much less Iran and North Korea. So I really do think that when you're talking about about proliferation issues, it's very country specific. And you really have to have a, you know, I mean, I know the lab doesn't, you know, generate regional experts, but one of the great things about Z Division when I first went there in 84 is that it was a nice mix of people who had regional expertise and real technical expertise, and I thought that was a powerful combination, which I think we have probably have better technical experts than we do regional experts these days. Yeah.
the immigrants from Russia, is it just because they come with all their baggage and so, you know, we really have to have our homegrown individuals?
Well, you know, one of the great strengths of America is that we, you know, because we are a, you know, nation of immigrants, we have not only Russians, but we have Chinese and Indians and Pakistanis and Iranians and so forth. But I meet quite a few people from those different backgrounds who've worked into government jobs. I mean, one of the huge things I noticed, big difference from when I served in Clinton and then when I served in Obama, there are a lot more South Asians in the government now. I don't remember ever meeting a South Asian, but now there are many of them. I mean, not just Muslims, but, you know, Christians and Sikhs and so forth. And I think that reflects the change in the population. So, you know, in 10 years we'll have Syrians working in the U.S. government.
So on that challenging thought, let me thank you for making time to come and meet with us today and for bringing such a broad perspective to this discussion. Very thought-provoking, a lot of good context for us to think about. Please join me in thanking Gary for joining us.
Thank you.